Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis brought to you by Shankara AS Academy. Here are the list of news articles chosen for discussion today, and our video is time-stamped for your convenience.
So, this article is about the ozone levels in the Delhi NCR region. See, earlier, unsafe ozone levels were a problem only during the summers. Now, a new study has found that it has become a problem across all seasons, even during winter. And with the analysis of this article, let us discuss about ozone, what is ground level ozone, why is it harmful, and we will also talk about ozone's role in the photochemical smog. So first, let us know what is ozone. See, oxygen as a molecule always exists as a pair. So one oxygen atom will always have a company of another oxygen atom. So, and together they will form an oxygen molecule, which we write as O2. But ozone is something that exists as three oxygen atoms. When one more oxygen atom gets added up to the normal oxygen molecule, it becomes ozone molecule. So ozone is nothing but O3. And if you see, generally ozone is found in the upper layers of the atmosphere called the stratosphere. And it is known for its good functions in the stratosphere. And we know they deflect the harmful UV radiations from the sun. And that is why we are very worried about the depletion of the ozone layer near the polar regions and all. But the story is different when the ozone occurs near the ground. See, look at this picture. This is a very good picture about how the atmosphere is layered. And you can also see the ozone layer. Yeah, it has a spelling error. But that is where the ozone layer exists. And you can see that is where the aeroplanes generally travel in the stratosphere. And the hot air balloons are depicted where they actually fly. And of course, the clouds are in the troposphere within the layer in which we are living. And We have the satellites, which in the thermosphere beyond the Kármán line. See, Kármán line is nothing but the generally accepted line between the Earth and the space. So it kind of delineates the Earth's atmosphere and the space. Generally, it is located at 100 kilometers from the Earth's surface. So that is all you will have to know about Kármán line. Now, let's come back to the discussion. So we were talking about ozone. Let us see how ground level ozone is formed, because that is something which is very harmful. See, unlike the normal diatomic molecules of oxygen, ozone is poisonous when it occurs in the ground level. And ozone is also a secondary pollutant that forms from the interaction between the primary pollutants, such as hydrocarbons and nitrogen oxides in the presence of a sunlight. So remember, this is a secondary pollutant, not a primary pollutant, because its place is in stratosphere. But in here, it is being synthesized under the effect of sunlight and other hydrocarbons. So ozone in troposphere is a secondary pollutant. And its formation is mainly from automobile emissions. Now, let us see the harmful effects of the ground level ozone. See, if a person has an intense exposure to surface ozone, the person may actually develop symptoms of a decrease in lung functions. The person may develop pneumonia easily, and influenza could get serious in that particular person, and asthma can get serious, and others. And it may also cause the temperature of the atmosphere to rise, resulting in greenhouse gas as well. So it also contributes to the global warming. So let us see more about this photochemical smog. But before that, let know that there are two types of smog. One is the classical smog and the other one is photochemical smog. See, this classical smog is nothing but the smog that occurs in the cold and humid climate. That is when the smoke mixes with the fog. And fog is a trademark of a cold and humid climate, isn't it? So when smoke mixes with fog and sulfur dioxide, smog happens. And this particular mixture has a reducing property. That is, the mixture is reducing. So it is also called as reducing smog. Remember, classical smog is reducing smog. Now let us see the photochemical smog. So it is completely opposite to the classical smog. What happens is, the photochemical smog occurs in warm, dry and sunny climate. in contrast to the classical smog. And sunlight is an essential feature for the photochemical smog to form. And this mixture of photochemical smog has oxidizing properties, and that is why photochemical smog is also called as oxidizing smog. And in the photochemical smog, we also have the ozone, which is rich in oxygen. So anything rich in oxygen can be an oxidizing agent, right? So remember that way, and that is exactly why photochemical smog is also called as an oxidizing smog. So when fossil fuels are burnt, let us see the formation. When the fossil fuels are burnt, why are they burnt? For the fuels, right? When petrol and diesel are burnt, two important pollutants are emitted into the troposphere. They are hydrocarbons released from unburnt fuels and nitric oxide, which is NO. And when these pollutants reach high levels, a chain reaction occurs from their interaction with the sunlight. And because of this, the nitric oxide is converted into nitrogen dioxide, and this nitrogen dioxide in turn absorbs the energy from the sunlight and breaks up into nitric oxide and free nitrogen atom. See, both nitric oxide and free oxygen atom, both are very, very reactive species. They are very unstable. They are looking for compounds to bond with. And so what happens is the free oxygen combines with the normal oxygen, that is O2, which is abundant in the troposphere, and becomes O3. So why is this symbol here? Because the ozone in itself is an unstable molecule. So it can disintegrate into oxygen and oxygen atom, and that is why we have this symbol. And this makes ozone as a potential oxidizing agent. The ozone here forms is looking to react, isn't it? So it reacts rapidly with nitric oxide gas formed earlier in the first reaction. And this leads to nitrogen dioxide and oxygen. And this nitrogen dioxide is a brown gas. And this brown gas is responsible for the haze in the atmosphere that occurs due to this particular smog. And see, ozone at the ground level is a toxic gas. And NO2 and O3 are strong oxidizing agent. Therefore, they can react with the unburnt hydrocarbons to produce harmful chemicals subsequently. So why do we have unburnt hydrocarbons in the air? See, when a diesel and when a motorcycle or when a car, generally when it runs on diesel or petrol, the emitted gas contains a lot of hydrocarbons that are still not processed, which is partly burnt or completely unburnt. They are also given out from the vent. So that is also there in the air, and these unburnt and partially burnt hydrocarbons are much more harmful than the fully burnt ones, because the fully burnt ones will come out as carbon dioxide, whereas this partly burnt ones, they come out and they act as the pollutants, and they participate in these kind of reactions resulting in harmful byproducts. So now coming back to the discussion, so these reactive species, they react with the volatile organic compounds or these unburnt hydrocarbons, and they result in some of the harmful chemicals like formaldehyde, acrolein and peroxyacyl nitrate. So don't think about the formulas and all. Just remember these names alone, which you may find in the preliminary exam. So therefore, the photochemical smog consists of these chemicals. And we saw if ozone, if not present there, would not be producing such chemicals. So we worry more about the ground level ozone. And this is the role of ozone in the formation of photochemical smog. And the effects of photochemical smog can be quite harmful, because the byproducts, say things like peroxyacyl nitrate, formaldehyde, they're all toxic chemicals, and they can range in various symptoms, ranging from first eye irritations or breathing difficulties, headache, cough, you know. And in plants also, they are reported to stunt the growth of the plants. So not just in social animals like us, the photochemical smog also has an effect on the plants, and it also has effects on the non-living stuff like that of metals and stones. They corrode all these things and they diminish the longevity of these stuffs in the surroundings. So this is why photochemical smog is very harmful. So remember the chemical names that is formed in the photochemical smog, which can prove harmful. And remember, photochemical smog is a oxidizing mixture. So, and it has ozone in it, and roughly go through the reactions that we just discussed. And also remember, what is a classical smog and how is it different from the photochemical smog. With that, we have come to the end of discussion on this particular topic. Let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now have a look at this editorial. This editorial is a critical analysis of the privileges of the state legislatures. It stems from the recent verdict of the apex court in the Kerala Assembly Ruckus case. So today, let us see what are these privileges, backgrounds of this case, and the verdicts observed by the Supreme Court in this regard. Here is the syllabus for your reference. First, let us understand what is privilege. See, privilege literally means a special right or an advantage, or you can say an immunity that is granted or is available only to a particular person or a group. And in this regard, the Constitution provides certain privileges for the Parliament and the state legislatures and to its members as well. We saw about parliamentary privileges, if at all you remember, a few days ago. And if you see, the Constitution provides for the privileges of a state legislature under Article 194. And here, the privileges refer to a sum of a special rights, immunities and exemptions which are enjoyed by the House of the State Legislature, their committees and their members. So you may ask, why do they need such privileges? See, mainly they serve one distinctive purpose. The point is, they safeguard the integrity of the legislative functions without any obstructions. And such obstructions could be caused by either the members themselves or even by the non-members. So the privileges are directed for the members, against the members as well as against the non-members also. And if you see, also they are necessary to secure the independence and the effectiveness of the actions of state legislature, their committees and their members. See, these are important because without these privileges, the houses cannot maintain their authority, dignity, honor, and also it cannot protect the members from any obstruction in the discharge of the legislative responsibilities. Above all, the privileges is an important tool also to ensure their independence. All right. Now, these privileges are of two broad categories. One is the collective privilege. That is, those privileges that are enjoyed by each house of the state legislature collectively. Right. For example, courts are prohibited to inquire into the proceedings of the House or its committees. And all these are collective privileges because it is enjoyed by the houses collectively. So have a look at it. See, these collective privileges are verbatim same for the legislature also. So go through it. First is right to publish its reports, debates and proceedings, and right to prohibit others from publishing the same. So it basically reserves the right to tell the public what is to be reported and what is not to be reported, say by it itself or by the others also. And second point is, it can exclude the strangers from its proceedings. And third is holding secret sittings to discuss some important matters. So basically, the house itself decides when to sit, where to sit, and whom to include and whom to exclude. So that is the amount of power that the house wields. Next is framing rules to regulate its own proceedings and the conduct of its business and to adjudicate upon such matters. So the legislative bodies, they themselves make their rules. They don't depend on any other external body to make rules for themselves. So they govern themselves by their own rules, right? And nextly, punishing members and outsiders for breach of its privileges or its contempt by reprimand, admonition or imprisonment. Also suspension or expulsion in case of its members. See, this is about state legislature we are talking right now. But if you think about the national legislature, what happened is in 1978, our late prime minister, who was expelled under the privileges ground. The late Prime Minister was expelled from the house and was also imprisoned for the breach of privilege. In 1978, the Prime Minister was none other than Indira Gandhi herself. She was not a Prime Minister then, but yes. And next is the right to receive immediate information of the arrest, detention, conviction, imprisonment and release of a member. And the next is about instituting inquiries and the order of attendance of witness and send for relevant papers and records. So basically 6 and 7 says that it kind of acts like a judicial body which can seek information and seek the presence of a member whenever it wants, right? And coming to the 8th point, the courts are prohibited to inquire into the proceedings of a house or its committee. So this again sets up the independence of the state legislatures. And the last is, no person can be served within the precincts of the house without the permission of the presiding officer. So as you can see, the entire premises of the legislature serves as a fort for the members of the legislative assembly. And coming to back to that discussion, second is the individual privileges. Till now we were talking about the collective privileges. Now we are going to talk about the individual privileges. Individual privilege means the privileges that are enjoyed by the members individually. So these are, one, in civil cases, members cannot be arrested in three instances. First, during the session of the state legislature, when the session is in progress, say a monsoon session is going on, during that time, a state legislative member cannot be arrested. Next is 40 days before the beginning of session and 40 days after the end of such session. So some session is beginning, 40 days before that and after that session also the member enjoys the immunity. But note that this is only for the civil cases and it is not available for criminal cases or preventive detention cases. Remember, this could be a very tricky potential preliminary question. All right. Next, as per Article 194(1), members have the freedom of speech in the state legislature. And as per Clause 2, no member is liable to any proceedings in any court for anything that is said in the floor of the legislature. But this freedom is subject to provisions of the Constitution, of course, and it is subject to the rules and the standing orders regulating the procedures of the legislatures. So what is the case that demands us to discuss the privileges? See, the case pertains to the Kerala Legislative Assembly commotion that happened way back in 2015-16 itself. So what happened was, when the finance minister of the state was presenting the budget, certain MLAs from the opposition party created a scene. We all know the legislative assemblies and the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha are areas of immense entertainment, right? So what they did was they disrupted the presentation of the budget. Not just that, they climbed over the speaker's dais and damaged the furniture as well. And computer and other stuffs was also destroyed. So cumulatively, the loss was around 2,20,000. The legislative secretary, who is a parliamentary officer, filed a criminal case against these MLAs under the provisions of the IPC and the Prevention of Damage to Public Property Act of 1984. And this criminal case was filed and the matter was to be heard or tried in a court of law, of course. But in 2018, the assistant public prosecutor filed an application to withdraw the case against the MLAs. And one of the main reasons given for demanding to withdraw the prosecution was the event is protected under the immunities and the privileges of the state legislature. And the prosecutor argued that the events that transpired during that particular session of the legislative assembly, when certain MLAs protested against the budget presentation, was within the umbrella protection that is being provided in the Constitution. So the event is protected by the immunities under Article 194(3) of the Constitution. And the prosecutor argued that the protest comes under individual privilege because member of the legislature, including the opposition member, has the right to protest the floor of the legislature. And this right is deemed as a implicit right under Article 194(1), which provides for freedom of speech on the floor of the legislature. But the chief judicial magistrate declined this withdrawal. So the case went to High Court, which upheld the chief judicial magistrate's decision. And finally, the matter came before the Supreme Court. So what has the Supreme Court said? Now the Supreme Court has declared that committing acts of destruction of public property cannot be equated with either the freedom of speech in the legislature or with the forms of protest that is legitimately available to the members of opposition. And the Supreme Court has also observed that the legislative privileges cannot be claimed to seek exemption from the application of criminal law. And the privileges are there to enable the legislators to perform their functions without hindrance or fear or favor, and to create an environment to support the same. So the privileges are not a mark of status which makes the legislators to stand on an unequal pedestal. And it also held that the acts of vandalism cannot be said to be a manifestation of freedom of speech. And this we all agree. And it cannot be termed as a proceedings of the assembly. And see, we already saw no member is liable to any proceedings of the legislature. And that is why now the Supreme Court has clarified that destruction of public property and vandalism are not proceedings of an assembly, even though it happened when the session was going on. So, author of the editorial concludes by welcoming the interpretation of the Supreme Court, because the legislative privilege cannot be used as a cover for such behaviors in the house, and the author calls it as a crime in the house. So with that, we have come to the end of the discussion on this particular editorial. With that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion.
Now look at this news article. See, according to this article, the Srivilliputtur Grizzled Squirrel Wildlife Sanctuary in Tamil Nadu has the highest leopard density, not only in the state of Tamil Nadu, but also in the entire Western Ghats landscape. This conclusion was made based on a report, and the report's title is Status of Leopards, Co-Predators and Mega Herbivores in India 2018. This report was released by the Environment and Forest Ministry. See, according to this report, the population of leopards in the state of Tamil Nadu is in the range of 828 to 908, a tentative range. And this report also noted that the growing human population and the increasing fragmentation of the landscape had increased the human-animal interactions. So these are the important points from this article that is relevant for our exam. In this context, let us see about leopards. See, the scientific name of leopard is Panthera pardus. And historically, if you see, the leopards were found in many places. They were found in sub-Saharan and the Northern African region. They were found in Middle East. They were found in Asia Minor. They were found in South and Southeast Asia, and they were found in the islands of Sri Lanka and Java. They were also found in parts of Russia as well. So we can see that they existed in a wide-ranging habitat. Have a look at the map. See, leopards were found in almost every kind of habitat, right? That's what we just saw. And from the rainforest of the tropics to deserts to the temperate region, they have survived everywhere. This is because they are adaptable animals with respect to habitat and the food requirement. They're very accommodative animals. But the contemporary records suggest that even this accommodative animal has shrunk in its historical global range. Right now, they are only spread across 25% of its original habitat. That is, the 75% of the habitat is already lost, or they do not inhabit those habitats. Only in 25% they exist. And this is an indication of decline in the population, and the global range is reducing, right? Now, let us take a look at Indian leopard. See, the scientific name of Indian leopard is Panthera pardus fusca. And it is a leopard subspecies widely distributed on the Indian subcontinent. And this subspecies has faced huge threats due to habitat loss and fragmentation, of course. And it is also being poached for its skin and body parts. You know how beautiful a leopard skin is. So it is very often poached for it. And it is also facing persecution due to human-animal conflict situations. Recently also there was a clip on India Today that went viral on Instagram and Twitter, where a leopard which entered a human habitat was beaten up and it was dragged out of the village that it was captured from. Now coming to the conservation status of the leopards. See, the leopards are listed as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List, and it is also listed in Appendix 1 of the CITES. What is CITES? Convention on International Trade of Endangered Species of Wildlife, Fauna and Flora. And in India, if you see, it is provided the highest level of protection under the Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. See, we know in India, Schedule 1 animals enjoy the highest amount of protection, whereas Schedule 3 and Schedule 4 animals enjoy the least amount of protection, but still they enjoy the protection. So these are the important points regarding the conservation status of leopards. Now moving on to Grizzled Squirrel Wildlife Sanctuary. See, this sanctuary is also known as Srivilliputtur Wildlife Sanctuary, that is discussed in the news article. And this wildlife sanctuary is found in the western Tamil Nadu. And if you see, the sanctuary lies mostly in the districts of Virudhunagar and Madurai. And both these districts are in Tamil Nadu. And this sanctuary was established in 1988 only to protect the grizzled giant squirrel. Have a look at the picture for an idea on the grizzled giant squirrel. So also have some knowledge about the grizzled giant squirrel. See, owing to habitat loss, poaching and the human intervention, the grizzled giant squirrel has been categorized as near-threatened by the IUCN. And it is listed under Schedule 2 of the CITES. And in India, we have protected the squirrel under Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So this brings us to the end of this discussion on this particular news article. With that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion.
Now look at this news article. This article is regarding the high security registration plate. See, recently our Ministry of Road Transport and Highways has mandated all vehicles to have a high security registration plate, which is HSRP. So all new vehicles which were sold from 1st of April 2019 were pre-fitted with the high security registration plates. Also, the central government has mandated high security registration plates for vehicles which were sold before April 2019 as well. So, if a vehicle has an old plate, it has to replace it with a HSRP or high security registration plate. If not, the vehicle will be fined. Now, in this context, let us discuss the HSRP. First, what is HSRP? See, high security registration plate is made up of aluminium and it is fixed on the vehicle using two non-reusable locks. And the registration plates come with a hot stamped chromium based hologram of Ashok Chakra on the top left corner, which is blue in color. You can see in the picture, and it precisely measures 20 mm to 20 mm. Right, and in the bottom left corner of the plate we have this 10 digit PIN, permanent identification number, that is laser engraved on the reflective sheet. And similarly, the HSRP also comes with a hot stamped film applied on the registration numerals and the letters bearing the inscription India at 45 degree angulation. And once a unique registration is fixed, it is then electronically linked to the vehicle. So this takes us to the question as to why do we need a HSRP? Why not normal plates, right? See, the old number plates were quite easy to tamper with. What will these car dealers do is they take off the old plates, they easily switch it into a new one and they attach it to the vehicle and the vehicle becomes a new vehicle. You understand. So it became easier for them to steal the vehicles. And a stolen vehicle always ends up with a replaced registration plate, which makes it difficult for the authorities to even track it down. They just simply have to track it down by the other features of the vehicle. But the HSRPs come with a non-removable snap-on lock. And these locks are quite difficult to replace. See, the HSRP are also beneficial because the essential details of a car, including the engine number and the chassis number, are stored in a centralized database. And the stored data along with the 10-digit PIN becomes crucial in identifying a stolen car or a bike. So the HSRP will aid our search in identifying the stolen vehicle, and it will also deter the thefts. So how much does this HSRP cost? See, the price has not been fixed by the central government yet. So on an average, generally costs between 400 for two-wheelers and about 1,100 for about four-wheelers. So it is quite variable across the states. So this is all about HSRP that you'll have to know. See, this is very important for your preliminary point of view only. So you don't have to consider it for your main exam. So with that, we have come to the end of discussion on this particular topic. Let's move on to the next topic in question. So let us take up this news article for our discussion. This news article reports about the excess death cases in Punjab. So the only takeaway from this article for our exam is knowing about excess deaths. See, as per the news, the number of excess deaths registered by the civil registration system since the start of the pandemic was found to be 3.3 times the official reported figures of the COVID-19 deaths for the same period. So in this context, we'll see some basics about the excess deaths. See, the excess mortality or the deaths is a term used in epidemiology and public health. So what does it mean? This excess mortality or death provides an estimate of the additional number of deaths within a given time period in a geographical region compared to the number of deaths expected or estimated using the same time period in the preceding year or the averaged over several preceding years. So let us understand it better. Say we have a district A. So in 2018, say it has registered 50 deaths. Say by middle, the 2019 pandemic sets in, and they say the number of deaths that has occurred in the same district A is 150. And officials report that 50 deaths are due to other causes, say because of aging or other causes like heart attack or cancers, you know, other life-threatening diseases, same as the previous year. And we have the another 50, which is caused by the pandemic. And that is what has been reported by the healthcare institutions or by the governmental agencies. And we have another 50, which is unaccounted for compared to the previous year. And this 50 is what we call as excess death, along with the another 50 that has been caused by the pandemic. So cumulatively, 100 deaths has been caused extra by the pandemic compared to the previous year. And this is how we are calculating the excess deaths. And for our additional information, remember that India's death registration system started in 1860s in response to cholera pandemic. That is, we actually started counting the number of dead in particular area only in the 1960s in response to a pandemic. So before that, the number of births were registered, but the deaths were not registered. And note that as per the WHO report, the COVID-19 excess mortality takes into account both the total number of deaths directly attributed to the virus as well as the indirect impact, such as disruption to essential health services or travel disruptions. See, the estimations of the excess deaths gives a summary of the whole system impact of the pandemic. And they also play an important role in providing information about the real situation associated with the COVID-19 pandemic, like the deaths that are directly or indirectly attributed to COVID-19. So what is this indirectly attributed to COVID-19? See, we all know during the pandemic, the hospitals were overwhelmed. Most of the priority was given to the COVID patients. And what happened was other diseases were neglected. say a patient had to come in for a mild heart attack, he might have survived with some preliminary treatment, but that person might have lost his life because of the lack of availability of a hospital bed. So here it is indirectly attributed to COVID. The death of the person is indirectly attributed to COVID-19. And apart from that, the lockdowns had put a lot of pressure, economic pressure on the masses. So a lot of people got poor, a lot of people got hungry, especially the roadside people who depend a lot on the people who provide them food. Due to lockdown, they were left hungry. So few people lost their lives on the platforms as well. So this is also indirectly attributed to COVID-19. These are just few causes that are indirectly attributed to COVID-19, just for your understanding. But there are many other causes that has caused the deaths indirectly, which can be related to COVID-19. And in addition to that, they can also be standardized based on age or population size for comparability purposes between countries. See, calculating excess deaths not only helps us in capturing the true scale of tragedy, but in addition to that, they also help us in planning better for the next waves of the pandemic. The government might actually know the gravity of the situation. So it is due to these reasons, there continues to be an increasing emphasis on the need for authentic and proper death reports. So with this, we have come to the end of this discussion on excess deaths. So this is mainly a preliminary question. You probably should know what is excess deaths in proper terms so that you can get one preliminary question based on this particular article. With that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion.
Now let us take up this particular news article. So this news article asks us to take a different perspective of the Himalayas itself. I mean, beyond the security question that we always think about. So let us look at it in detail. Here is the syllabus covered by this news article. See, we cannot deny that we are examining the Himalayan region mainly through the prism of geopolitics and security. And in that process, what we do is we actually underestimate other important areas. That is by presuming that they are all irrelevant. That is, the geopolitical and the security questions are much more important compared to anything else, and the other things become completely wiped out from the policy decisions. And in fact, our concerns over Himalayas largely surrounds the assumption of fear, suspicion, rivalry, invasion, encroachment, and quarrel with the other neighboring countries. I mean, it's not that we are to blame. Of course, we have hostile neighbors like that of Pakistan and China with we have been on war. And because of that, what has happened is Himalayas have been viewed only as a security question. And Himalayas have been viewed in respect to some other country only. And this is what author calls as extroversion approach. That is, our understanding, focus and importance are conceived by what lies outside the Himalayas than what is lying inside our borders. To put it in other words, our concerns about the Himalayas are defined based on the Delhi, Beijing, Islamabad triad rather than our own needs or the people's needs. And this idea of extroversion tendencies has led to the political compulsion of territorializing the Himalayan region on a par with the vital importance of nationalism. See, how is that? See, the territorialization of Himalayas has got colonial legacy. So what does that mean? Even during the colonial times, the Himalayan region was seen as an area to have control on, area for power play itself. And this trend continued even after the colonialism, and the destiny of the territorialization continued in the Himalayan region. So adding to this lack of stable relationship between the five nation states falling within the Himalayan landmass, which has further prevented them from arriving at an approach beyond the territoriality and the sovereignty. And it is these reasons which paves the way for tensions while working out the projects predicted upon the national sovereignty. So here, let us see The author has said five nations as Nepal, Bhutan, India, Pakistan, and Tibet. See, note that Tibet is not a separate nation. It's a very contentious thing to say. But just go with the flow because the author just says so. It is author's opinion and it is not our opinion, right? So moving on with the article. For instance, the National Mission on the Himalayan Studies, which comes under our Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, allocates or provides funds for research and technological innovations. But what it does is, it creates policies only for the Indian Himalayan region. See, Himalayas is huge and what India has is much more limited, and making isolated policies for the Indian side of Himalayan region is very unproductive. See, Himalayan region is an ecosystem, a whole full ecosystem, not just from the ecological point of view, but also from the cultural point of view. Although it is not monolithic, although it has a lot of cultures in it, separating few cultures from the rest of the major culture is a very unprudent idea. And that is what the author notes. Now, by giving more importance to the map or the political fixations as the natural limit, we are actually overburdening the Himalayan studies mostly with the concerns of the state. That is, again, because we are relying on the political boundaries, which are not natural, right? We have divided Himalayas based on our needs, and these boundaries are not natural. So this unnatural boundaries within the states has resulted in a fragmented policy formation. And in this process, we are actually forgetting about the place held by the people, culture, market, or ecology in this context. So, according to the author, there is a need for us to clearly understand that the political borders and the cultural borders are not the same thing. The political borders should just be viewed as a space-making strategies of the modern nation-states, and they should not be coincided with the cultural borders. So let us understand it better. See, consider Northeast. It has a lot of small cultures, a lot of cultural groups that extends beyond the borders also. So especially along the Myanmar border, we have something called the free movement regime. So the people in the borders belonging to the same cultural group, they are free to move across the borders for up to 16 kilometers on the either side. They can exchange goods, their rituals, they can perform their cultural activities together. So thereby, this kind of cultural activities are preserved and their cultural practices are preserved, and the people's choices are given primacy, which in turn is a human right. So author says something of this sort. That is what he means when he says that the political borders should be viewed along with the cultural borders. And see, Himalayas being naturally evolved had to be understood through frameworks that have grown from within the Himalayas. Or in other words, it should be visualized with an open eye and it should be taken as a whole instead of a part. So rather than viewing only India's side of Himalaya, Himalaya should be viewed along with the entirety. And there are several alternate ways of looking at the geopolitical and the security concerns of Himalaya. But if territoriality, sovereignty differences continue to be in the limelight, then those of the anthropological, historical, cultural and the ecological ones, then such an approach would result to be un-Himalayan, or for that matter, antithetical to the idea of the Himalaya itself. So basically, the author, what he tries to say is to view the Himalayas as a whole is important, not just ecologically, but also culturally, it is very important. And this will give importance to the people and the cultures which have been inhabiting the region for many years since the past. So what is the major takeaway from this editorial for the exam is that looking at Himalaya from a different perspective is important, and the aspirants shall also have another view that Himalayas also have a culture and that should also be protected apart from the ecology and the political question. So this is the major takeaway from this editorial. With that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion.
Now here we are at the last segment of today's discussion, practice preliminary question session. We have 5 questions for discussion today. Let's go over it one by one. So the first question is about ozone. It's a 3-statement question and we are asked to identify the correct statement. So first statement is this: ozone is a primary pollutant when it occurs in the stratosphere. So from our discussion, it is clear that statement 1 is wrong because it is a secondary pollutant. Now moving on to the next statement, ozone is a greenhouse gas. Yeah, this statement is correct, which we saw in the discussion. And coming to statement 3, ozone is the most toxic constituent of the photochemical smog. Yes, this statement is also correct. For this question is option D, 2 and 3 only. Moving on to the next question. This question is about the leopards and the grizzled giant squirrel. See, some important species are very important and you'll have to be very familiar with their IUCN position especially. And you should also be aware of their Wildlife Protection Act status, which is granted in India. So let's go into the question. Leopards are listed as endangered on IUCN red list. See, this statement is incorrect because leopards are listed as vulnerable in the IUCN red list. Next is grizzled giant squirrel are listed as vulnerable on the IUCN red list. This is also wrong because the grizzled giant squirrel are listed as near threatened on the IUCN red list. So our correct option is option D, neither 1 nor 2. Moving on to the third question. It's again a 2-statement question. So it is about the HSRP that we saw in the discussion today. The first statement is this: high security registration plate is made up of aluminium and is fixed on the vehicle using 2 non-reusable locks. So this statement is right. We saw this in the discussion. Second is, high security registration plate is not easy to tamper with because of non-removable snap-on locks. So this is also right. And these two are like the potential advantages why we should adopt HSRP. So our correct option is option C, both 1 and 2. That is, both the statements are correct. And besides this, regarding HSRP, you will also have to remember the features of the HSRP, which is very important from the exam perspective. A question based on what are the features of HSRP can also be a potential preliminary examination question. Moving on to the next question. Which of the following gives the estimation of the additional number of deaths within a given time period compared to the deaths estimated during the same time period in the preceding year? So we discussed about excess mortality, and this statement in the question exactly defines excess mortality. So our correct option will be option A, excess mortality. Moving on to the last preliminary question for the day. It's a 2-statement question again, and we are asked to identify the correct statement. So this is about the privileges topic that we discussed today. The first statement is this: the members of the Legislative Assembly cannot be arrested during the session of the state legislature for both civil and criminal cases. See, while I was discussing itself, I told you to pay attention there, because the privileges are very relevant for the civil cases but not for criminal cases. So statement 1 is wrong. Coming to the second statement, Constitution extends the privilege of the state legislature to those persons who are entitled to speak and take part in the proceedings of a house of the state legislature. See, this statement is correct. We will have to remember, so this is not only about the elected members of the state legislature or the nominated members of the state legislature. Anyone who can take part in the proceedings of the house of the state legislature are entitled for the privileges. So it means that even Attorney General, who can take part in the proceedings of the house, is entitled for these privileges. Keep that in mind. So with that, we are wrapping up our preliminary questions discussion. Here is one mains question that we took from today's discussion on one particular editorial. Write the answers and post it in the comment section. Writing answers every day for your mains preparation will give you a significant edge compared to the others in the GS preparation for the mains. Don't forget to post it in the comment section for peer review. With that, let's wind up our discussion today. If you like the video, like, share, comment, and subscribe. Stay home, stay safe. Good day.